Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We appreciate your presence. We're glad you came to the house of the Lord. We welcome any visitor that might be visiting with us. And you that's listening out in the radio listen audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping the hour coming up, it can be a real inspiration to everyone. So if you get on the phone, you in the radio listen audience, have a phone available and call a friend, have them to tune in and get this hour coming up. I believe it would be a blessing to them. Take your Bible and turn, would you please, to John chapter 11. I'm speaking today on this subject. Back from the dead after 4 days. We have here a man that came back from the dead after 4 days. And this will be tape number 247. If you'd like to have a list of our cassette tape, just write in and say, Preacher Edward, send me a list of your cassette tape. I'll send you a list of at least 240 of our Sunday morning messages from Northside here. I'm sure it can be a blessing to you. Now, I'll be glad to send you these taped, a gift of $3 for each one. And the gift is used to help take care of our radio expense. And when you write in for the tape, then write in for a brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour for next year. After reading the brochure, you might really want to go on this wonderful tour. Turn to John chapter 11. Man back from the dead after 4 days, page 1130. Reminded of the man following the pallbearers as he carried his wife to the cemetery. They went under the arch. It was kind of rough as they went under the arch in the cemetery. He said to the pallbearers, he said, men, take it real easy, because this is where she revived the first time we brought her out here. So he wanted to be sure there's no shaking of the coffin. He didn't want her to revive up again. They might have to go back through that another time. John chapter 11. Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment, wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. And when Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. I might pause for just a moment and comment on that verse. Jesus said, this man is sick to the glory of God. Now you have these healing racketeers in the land today that tells you that everybody ought to be healed. And if a man is not healed, he doesn't have any faith, and all of his sickness is because of something he's done and things of that type. Better beware of these healing racketeers. I received a letter from a dear man the other day. He sent me a little old tin watch, a watch printed on a little piece of tin. And I think the time on it was 10 minutes till 12. And one of these healing racketeers had sent him that watch and told him to lay it beside of him that night. And then the next morning, mail it back to the racketeer, the healer, Rex Humbert. Because some of you don't like what I say about it. Well, you can stop up your ears. He's also a racketeer, healing racketeer. And Rex Humbert, whatever his name is, said, you mail this back in to me the next morning, and then your prayers will be answered, and all of the troubles will be solved, and things of that type. The man sent me the letter. He sent me the watch, a piece of tin with a picture of the watch on it. I have it here in my study. Now, what Rex Humbert wanted was the man to send the piece of tin back the next morning with an offering, with a gift. So these crooks out here in the ministry today that's preying upon poor sick people, they're racketeers. You better beware of them. And if you support them, you're going to be guilty of supporting heresy and racketeering that prey upon poor sick people. Any man that knows anything about the Bible should have sense enough to know that little old watch on that piece of tin. I'm talking about the the minister that sent it out, not the man that received it, the minister that sent it out, he knows that there's nothing to that. He knows it's only a trickery to get people to write in and send him money. And a man who'll do that is a crook, a religious crook. I don't care who he is. And there's a bunch of them in the land today. They're all over this country on TV and many of them on radio stations. And they're crooking poor, sick people out of their money to build up their own coffers, to build universities, and to put on a big show and make themselves popular. And poor old people today that don't know any better support that kind of stuff. You better get your eyes open and find out what you're supporting. And beware of these crooks. The land is filled with them. They're rising up every day. They're numerous in the land. God said they would come. And what you need to do is find out what your Bible has to say and stay with this book. And when these racketeers write in and try to trick you into sending them offerings, then you'll know they're a bunch of crooks and you won't be so gullible to send your offerings in to them if you know what the Bible teaches. Now back to this verse of scripture. When Jesus heard that, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby." Now there's some people sick today to the glory of God. There's no need of you praying to get well. You're not going to get well. There's some people, they die to the glory of God. There's no need for you to pray that God let you live, because you're going to die to the glory of God. If God answered all the prayers of people that wanted to live, then nobody would ever die, unless those that want to commit suicide. And then the Bible today lets us know there's some people that's going to remain sick until they die. Now, Paul had the power to heal, and he healed people. He had apostolic power. But one of his workers, Trophimus, was left at Miletus sick. Now, why didn't Paul heal Trophimus? He was one of his co-workers, but he didn't. He left him there a sick man. Now, some people are not going to be healed at the time they want to be healed. And some of them may never be healed. And if you're sick today to the glory of God, you might as well to ask God to give you grace to endure it. It could be like Paul's thorn in the flesh. You may have to suffer the rest of your days in ill health. God may not touch your body. Now, God can do it. And God does do it many times, but God doesn't do it to you and tell you you don't have any faith. Now you better watch out about this business. Now God can touch your body and God can heal you if he wants to. And God does heal some people, not through these healing racketeers, but through their faith in God as they pray. And maybe the pastor pray with them or the church pray with them. God can touch their bodies. He does that sometimes. Now, we have a lot of people in the land today that's making merchandise out of poor people in ill health and poor feeble people and aged people. And it's a racket, and you need to wake up and find out it's a racket, lest you be deceived and there support such evil. Now, notice verse 4 again. I want you to look at it. When Jesus heard that, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. And when he had heard therefore that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Then after that saith he to his disciples, "Let us go into Judea again." His disciples say unto him, "Master, the Jews have late sought to stone thee. Goest thou thither again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him." "These things," said he, and after that he saith unto them, "Our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may wake him out of sleep." Then said his disciples, "Lord, if he sleepeth, he'll do well." Howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking rest in sleep. Then said Jesus unto them, "Plainly, Lazarus is dead." Now, that's as far as I'm reading, because I want to get as much of the message out through the radio as possible this morning. You can read the remainder of the chapter. It can be helpful. But there's several things I want to say about this man that came back from the dead after 4 days. Now this is tape number 247 if you'd like to have it. Now the Bible speaks of seven people raised from the dead and two translated that they should not see death in the Bible. You'll find the son of the widow in Luke 17 and verse 14 raised from the dead. You'll find the son of the Shunammite woman in 2 Kings raised from the dead. You'll find the dead man cast in Elisha's grave raised from the dead. Lazarus here was raised from the dead. You find Tabitha raised from the dead. You find the daughter of Jairus raised from the dead. You find Eutychus raised from the dead. And you find Enoch and Elijah translated that they might not see death. So you have seven people in the Bible raised from the dead that's recorded in the Word of God. You have two that translated that never saw death. Now Lazarus here is a representative man. He represents all sinners. He's a type of that man that's dead in trespass and sins. Now the human race lay dead in trespasses and sins for 400 years before the resurrection of life came on the scene, which was Christ. Now those 400 years, we find these 4 days to be typical of 400 years before, 4,000 years, I'm sorry, 4,000 years before Jesus came on the scene. He lay in the grave 4 days, a day with the Lord, 1,000 years a day. And those 4 days, typical of the 4,000 years of the human race in sin before Jesus, who is the resurrection life, came on the scene to take care of that situation. Now, he's type of a sinner. I want to show several things about it. Number one, the Bible said Lazarus is dead. Now, you can't be any more dead than just plain dead. And verse 14, then said Jesus unto them, Lazarus is dead. All sinners today are dead, spiritually speaking. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and dead in sins. In 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 6, the Bible says, she that liveth in pleasure is dead while she liveth. Every sinner today that's not saved is dead, spiritually speaking. He's alive manward, but he's dead Godward. He's just as dead spiritually as this desk of which I place my hand. He doesn't know anything about spirituality because he's dead in sins according to the Bible. And the Bible said dead men cannot please God. I don't care what they do. That is sinners, lost people. In Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6, the Bible said without faith, it's impossible to please God, and dead men, lost men, sinners don't have any faith in God. They have no faith because they're dead. They only get that faith when they're born again and quickened by the power of God. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 55 verse 3, hear and your soul shall live. Now they got to hear the word of God and be quickened by the power of God, or they're not going to live. And that's the only way they'll hear is by the word of God and the power of God's Spirit giving them an ear to hear that they might repent and believe. Number two, the Bible said this man was corrupt. He had been dead 4 days. I've been over there. I've been in his tomb. I've been there where they placed him when he died and the place where he came out. I've been there many times there at Bethany at the home of Mary and Martha. And so he was corrupt in verse 17. The Bible said when Jesus came, he found him in the grave 4 days. Now that's a picture of a sinner who is corrupt and in sin. God gives us a description of that sin in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 6. He said the whole body, the whole head is sick and the whole heart is faint. From the sole of the foot, even on the head, there's no soundness in it but wounds and bruises. And putrefying sores have not been clothed, neither marred up with ointment. And so we find that that sinner is corrupt. His life is corrupt. His way is corrupt before God. Romans, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 3, gives us another picture of that sinner. He says in verses 13 and 14, their throat is an open sepulchre. With their tongue they have used deceit. The poison asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. That's a description of the lost man without God today. He's living a corrupt life. And God tells about him in the Bible. And he can't be cured or healed or saved until he comes to know the Lord. And God takes care of that corrupt situation. Number three, we find that Jesus loved this man. Now, in spite of the fact that he'd been sick and died, Jesus still loved him. In verses 3 through 5 of chapter 11 of John, therefore his sisters said unto him, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. Now, Jesus loves all sinners. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. The Bible said, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. That's what Jesus did. And so Jesus loved him. And when Jesus heard, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Now if you're out there in the radio listening audience and you're a sinner, you're lost, you're without God, you had a rough night last night, you drunk too much booze, you showed out, you acted a fool, you're ashamed of it today, but God still loves your soul. God doesn't love your sin, he loves your soul, and God will save you if you repent and trust Christ as your Savior. God loves the souls of men, and you need to realize that. There's a story told of a dying preacher whose members prayed for his recovery, telling the Lord how he loved him, and the preacher said, my imperfect love toward him is no comfort. Tell of his perfect love toward me. Not that we love God, but God loved us. God loved you. God loved me. Or I wouldn't be standing here preaching the gospel today. I was a sinner, a wicked sinner, and God loved me, and God saved me, and God saved you, and God will save anyone that really means business. Number four, when Jesus came to this grave where they had buried Lazarus, he found a stone in the way. In those days, they put a stone over the mouth of the cave where they buried people. They buried people in caves in those days, and they rolled a stone at the mouth of the cave. In verse 39, Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Then Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he's been dead 4 days. Jesus said, move that stone out of the way. He came to the mouth of that grave, and there was a stone that covered the entrance thereof. And Jesus said, I want the stone moved out of the way. And then the Mary said to him, now Lord, Martha did rather, he stinks by now. He's been dead 4 days. Very hot in that part of the country in summertime, and decomposition sets in very early. And so he said, by now he stinketh. Now he smelled, he has a bad odor. But Jesus said, get the stone out of the way. Now that Lazarus here is a type of that sinner. And the reason a lot of sinners are not saved today, we have too many stumbling stones in the way. It's a shame and a pity at God's people letting stumbling stones get in the way of a poor lost sinner. You have people, they get mad and peeved about nothing and pout and won't be in church like they ought to and won't be found at their post of duty where they should be, pouting, mad, got a burr in the saddle somewhere, and they want to pout about it. Well, God Almighty is not pleased with that. Now, you need to realize that what you do for God, do it because you love the Lord, and don't look for something to pout about. A lot of people carry a chip around on the shoulder and dare anybody to knock it off. Now, sometimes I kind of hate to knock those chips off because it might have come out of the head and they need it up there in their head where they can have some more sawdust kept in. But, beloved, we need to realize that a lot of people just looking for something when they get peeved off about something the preacher said or something somebody did or what they don't like in the church, they start sniffing around like a dog trying to smell a rabbit track to try to find something to be peeved about. Now, that's a shame. That's a pity. That's like a bunch of children that Paul said was over at Corinth, a bunch of babies. You shouldn't be looking for things to get mad about or peeved off about or want to fuss on the preacher about or the deacons or teachers or whatnot. You ought to always be looking for something to help or be of help that you might carry on the work of God, not be a bunch of babies. Now, these stumbling stones can hinder sinners. When a bunch of sinners see a Christian people that are miffed about something, or pouting, or gossiping, or things of that type, those sinners say, well, if they're going to act like that, then I'm about as good a shape as they are. The trouble is they don't know they're going to hell and the Christians are going to heaven, but they'll use that as an excuse. Now, that's the old stumbling stone. When I'm in the way, the stone of worldliness. You can be so worldly until that sinner can't see the difference between you and the man that's living out in the world, and that becomes a stumbling stone. If you're going to live like that sinner, go the places he go, do the things that he does, you'll never win that sinner to God. You're a stumbling stone. You're in the way of that sinner. He's not coming to God. He's watching you. And if you're living like he's living, then he's not coming to God. That's a stumbling stone in his way, and every Christian need to be careful about that. Then there's a stone of prayerlessness. If we never pray, if we don't pray as we should, we're not going to touch sinners for God. The great soul winners in this world today and in days gone by have been men that could pray. Men and women that could lay hold on God. Men and women that spend time in prayer. Now, when you spend time in prayer, you're going to touch somebody for God. Old Charles D. Finney, that great evangelist, just walked through a mill one day, a cotton mill, and as he walked through the mill, people saw him and fell under conviction just as he walked through. He was passing through a town one day in his buggy and stopped, and there's a man standing on the corner, and that man saw Charles D. Finney and fell under conviction of sin, wanting to be saved. That was a man of prayer. You could feel the influence of his praying wherever he went. Dwight L. Moody walked into a barbershop one day, sat down in the chair, got a haircut, and then he went out, and some man said, I don't know who that fellow was, but when he came in and sat down, I felt different. I felt a holy hush come over this place. I felt like I was in the presence of God. Can somebody tell me who that man was? They said, that man is Dwight L. Moody. Oh, I see then why this atmosphere is like this. God was in this place in Dwight L. Moody. And without praying, you can't touch that sinner for God. And prayerlessness is a stone in our way in reaching people for God. Then there's the stone of ill will among Christians. It's a shame to have ill will among God's people. But when you have a bunch of babies that never grow and never feed on God's word like they should, not active in God's work like they ought to be, then it's very easy for them to have ill will in their hearts among other Christians. That should not be. That's bad. That's wrong. And then there's a stone of evil speaking. I've known people say they were saved and stand around a bunch of sinners in the presence of a bunch of sinners and speak evil of other Christians and preachers and churches. You should never criticize God's people. You should never criticize God's true church and God's true men in the presence of lost sinners. They want to hear that. That's what they're looking for. And if they can hear you say something evil about the church, about the preacher, about God's people, then, yeah, I thought that. And so, therefore, I won't be going to that church, and I won't be listening to that preacher because you just hear what the man said. Be careful about speaking evil about God's people around sinners. If you will discuss something with some brother or sister, you might pray about it. That's different. But don't talk evil, speak evil of God's church and God's people, God's preachers around sinners. They may die and go to hell, and you'll be responsible for it. If you're a stumbling stone to that extent and they die and go to hell because of what you said, then God will hold you responsible. I've known men, I mean Christian people, that could be used. I've even known a preacher or two to my sorrow that run their mouths so much in where they labored until they just turned people off from God and turned people away from the church and turned people against Christians. And those sinners went out and believed a lot of stuff they heard, and those fellows are going to answer God for sinners going to hell because they run their mouths too much. I've known men, I've known even ministers that run their mouths so much they run themselves out of the ministry. That's bad, isn't it? That's pitiful. And don't speak evil, don't do evil speaking among sinners. Be sure there's no sinner around here you saying something critical about the things of God, because they're looking for things to use that excuse to keep them from God and keep them out of the house of God and away from God. Be careful. Have your conversation seasoned with salt. Something to make them thirsty for God when you talk. Then there's your stone of unconcernedness. Now, a lot of people think, well, I member of the church, and some even have a position in the church, or where they've been appointed to by the church, and think, well, I don't feel like I'll get up and go to church today, or somebody else can do my job. You better do some thinking. You're going to ask God for that. If you have a position in the church and you're careless and unconcerned, you take that attitude, you better wake up. Time God gets through giving you a spanking and dealing with that thing that's keeping you out of the church, you may be left lonely and sad. You better realize that you're going to answer to God for your unconcernedness in God's house and God's work. If you have been placed in a position in the church by the pastor, by the people, you have responsibility not only to your church and your pastor, but to your God. And you'll answer to God for it. You can't take this thing lightly and get by with it. And because God's going to reward those that are faithful and love Him and be faithful in serving Him, God will reward them. But God's going to give people a good tanning that are careless, unconcerned, and disobedient, and always looking for something to sour up on God about and God's people and God's church. God will deal with them about that. The old stone of unconcernedness, and there's a stone of wrong instruction. When you're instructing people about the right way, be sure that you know what it's all about. If you start somebody on the wrong road by wrong instruction and they die and go to hell, and that's a stumbling stone to them, you'll answer to God for it. Be careful about these stumbling stones. I can stand here until 1 o'clock and name one stumbling stone after another that God's people place in the way of sinners and cause sinners to die and go to hell. Now, a lot of people say, I'm going to shout into heaven. I'm going to shout in. Well, you better be careful about that. You might not be shouting too much as you go in when you realize that sinners are in hell because of stones that you placed in the way of them. They might not be too much shouting about that on the other side. What you're going to shout about, if you shout at all, about something good that you have done, not some hindrance you've laid in the way or caused some sinner to go to hell. Number 5, we find this man here is raised from the dead, verse 44. And he that was dead came forth. Jesus stood there. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. Now, had not Jesus called him by name, everybody in that cemetery that knew God had jumped out of the grave. But Jesus said, Lazarus, come forth. And out of that grave came one man, and that was Lazarus. The rest of them didn't move. They stayed right there. God called him by his name. In verse 43, and when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. He didn't whisper and say to Lazarus, I want you to come forth. He cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Out of that grave he came, and God called him by name, and God knows your name, and God knows your house number, and God knows your phone number. God knows all about you. And God Almighty, when He saved you, He knew your name, knew where you live, your street number, your house number. God knows all about us. And He called him by name. God is just that much concerned about everyone. He's concerned about who they are, where they live, and what the address is. God is concerned about individuals. He certainly is. And so he came forth, and God alone could bring him out. All those people could do was move that stone. Those people got together and they moved that stone out of the way. And when they rolled that thing back, and those stones are usually very heavy, it takes more than one person to roll them away. And they moved that stone back, and Jesus yelled down into that grave and called Lazarus, told him to come out of there, and he came out of that grave. Now those people, Mary and Martha and their friends, could never call Lazarus out. But there's one thing they could do, and that's get the stone out of the way. Now, you can't save one sinner, not one. Nobody can save a man or a woman, no human being. The only thing you can do is get your stones out of the way. And when you get the stones out of the way, then Jesus can save that sinner. Jesus is the only one who can do it. He can save the sinner, but move the stones out first. Now, we need to realize that. So he called him out. Called him out of the grave, raised him from the dead. And the Bible tells us that God alone can do that. It's not reformation that people need today. Now, God doesn't say to that sinner, I want you to reform. I want you to reform and do a little better. No, no. God says, I want you to repent and believe on Jesus Christ and be saved. Now, that's what God wants. It's not reformation, not trying to do better, not turning over a new leaf, not just trying to do good, but God wants us to move the stones out of the way so he can resurrect that sinner. It's not reformation, not education, but resurrection that the sinner needs, spiritual resurrection. And God alone can do that. The Bible says that he came forth in number 6. He is set free in verse 44. He that was dead came forth bound with hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face is bound about with a napkin. And Jesus said unto him, loose him and let him go. Now Lazarus came out of that grave bound in grave clothes, wrapped up with grave clothes, linen clothes all around his body, a napkin about his head. All he could do is stand there like a mummy, a wooden Indian. He couldn't move. He was bound. He just came out of the grave. God lifted him out of just standing there with his grave clothes on. But Jesus said, now, all right, take his grave clothes off and set him free. In John chapter 8 and verse 36, if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Now, we have some saved people today. They have been saved, but they're standing around like a bunch of wooden Indians, a bunch of mummies, and doing nothing for God, and still got their grave clothes on. Now, God wants you to take your grave clothes off. Those old clothes you wore for the devil, get them off and wear clothes the glory of God. I'm talking about deeds and habits and things of that type. Some people are tied up by their habits. Old grave clothes still hanging on to them, bad habits. Others are tied, some preachers are tied by their church. They can only do what the church permits them to do. That's a shame. Some churches are tied up by associations. Some associations tied up by conventions. Some conventions tied up by denominations. You need to get your grave clothes off and remember, you are a free person. There's not a person in the world today that has any more liberty than a good old-fashioned, saved, born-again, independent Baptist church member. He has all the liberty in the world that he needs. God gives him that liberty. Nobody can dictate to him what to do. God gave him that liberty, and he's to be obligated to God and God alone as he serves the Lord. Don't get tied up in these grave clothes and drag them around. I see poor old church members tied up in grave clothes today until it's pathetic. They're afraid to come out of the apostasy. They're afraid to try to come out of denominations and churches that are dead. They're afraid to do so. They're wrapped up in their grave clothes and tied up tight and afraid to come out of them. You are at liberty to serve God, and you're not to be tied up by laws and creeds and forms and ceremonies and denominations and associations and religions and conventions. You're a free person in Christ, and you ought to appreciate that. Number 7, Lazarus came out. He had his grave clothes on. They stripped those grave clothes off, and then we see some signs of life. Number 1, in John chapter 12, verse 2, this man is eating. Therefore, they made a supper, and Martha served, but Lazarus, one of them that sat at table with him. Here's the man eating. That's a sure sign that he had been brought back from the dead. You know why a lot of church members, they don't care anything about the word of God? They're still dead. If you ever be made alive, then you'll have a desire to feed on the word of God. It's God's word. If you have no appetite for the word of God, you're still dead, no doubt. Now, dead men don't eat. And Lazarus is witnessing. John chapter 12, verses 10, 11. But the chief priests consented they might put Lazarus also to death, because by reason of him, many of the Jews were believing on Jesus. After this man came out of the tomb, brother, he started winning souls. He started witnessing. He got out and got busy for God. So he's witnessing. Number 3, he's winning souls. John chapter 12 and verse 11. Because by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Now, when God resurrected this man, made him alive, brought him out, took his grave clothes off, man, he started winning people to God right and left. He moved out for the Lord. Then finally, the believer sits at meat with God. You can't sit at meat with the Lord unless you're a believer. Chapter 12 and verse 2 of John, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Now, you're sitting here at God's table today, and you can enjoy this message if you're God's child. If you're not saved, it won't mean anything to you. But if you're saved, you can enjoy the word of God I've given you today. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 13, but now in Christ Jesus, you were sometime far off and made nigh by the blood of Christ. You're made now. You're brought into the family of God by his precious blood. And Ephesians chapter 2 verses 5 and 6 says, even when we were dead in sin, hath he quickened us together with Christ, by grace are you saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So we're sitting together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, sitting at God's table, enjoying the blessings of God and the food of God. And if you're a saved individual, that's no reason you shouldn't enjoy the preached word of God and being in God's services. If you don't, you better check up. You may be dead. If my preaching here today doesn't mean anything to you, and you see nothing in it, get nothing out of it, you are dead as a doornail. You need to repent and get saved. And when you repent and get saved, you can enjoy the blessings of God. Lazarus is dead. Been dead 4 days. Jesus resurrected him and brought him out after they moved the stones out of the way. It's our responsibility to get the stones away. It's God's responsibility to bring Lazarus out of the grave. Let's stand to our feet. Dear Father, today I pray that you take the message and use it. We know there's many lost people need to be resurrected spiritually. I pray you'll take your word and may the Holy Ghost take the sword of the word of God and penetrate it into the hearts of people, wherever they may be and wherever they may be listening. Have your way in this invitation, Father. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, while John is playing on the organ, listen to me. If you're in this building and you're not right with God, you want to come down here and get saved, you come on down here and let us help you. If you're a backslider and you want to come back to God, come on back. No better time would you find. If you're here and you feel like you've got some stones in the way and you'd like to get rid of them, come down here and get rid of them. This is the place to get rid of them. And then Jesus can raise the dead. There's many of a man sitting at home, lost sinner, and maybe his family goes to church and he sees so many stones in their lives, but they can't get him even to go to church. That's bad, isn't it? Or vice versa, husband and wife, or wife and husband, wife and children. We got to get the stones out if we expect Lazarus to come out of the grave. Got to do it. If God is speaking today, would you obey him while we wait? How about it? I brought the message that God laid on my heart. It's entirely up to you and I is what you do about it. You'd accept it. You'd act on it. You'd ignore it. You'd go out as though you'd never been in this building I'm talking about. But there's a God you must face about in eternity. How about it?